The love of God is greater far than time can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care, God gave His Son to win. His very child, He reconciled and parted from His sin. Oh, love of God, our risen pool, our desolate, that's all. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. When years of time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray or rocks and dew and mountains fall, God's love so sure shall still endure all measureless and strong. Redeeming grace to add a grace, the saints and angels song. God, I'm reaching you, I'll measure that song. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels song. Could we within the ocean fill and were the skies a fortune made, and every star on earth a grave, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would claim the ocean dry. No fruit of hope, unchain the whole, those threads from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich of you, how measureless and so long. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song.
Amen. Good morning. How's everybody doing? Well, Bill isn't here this morning. Bill's on vacation. Good for him. And if Bill's not here, there's no announcements because I don't learn them. So that's what you guys have a bulletin for, and that's what you read the announcements on the slides for. So welcome to Berean. This is your first time. We are a little crazy here, so hopefully everybody's made you feel welcome. And so, to do that, to further the welcoming, why don't you guys just take a few minutes and just greet the people next to you. Shake some hands. Let everybody know that you care that they're here. Please stand. Your name is light, our hope in darkness. Your name is strong to save the day.
Your name is great, our mighty fortress. When all else crumbles, you remain. Hallelujah to the one whose faithfulness goes on and on. This is our everlasting song. Glory to your name, our God and our Savior. Worthy of praise, all the praise, all the praise. Forever you reign, almighty Redeemer. We are saved, we are saved, we are saved. Glory to your name, your name. Glory to your name, your name. For those in chains, your name is freedom. Your name is mercy for the lost. Your name is life poured out for sinners. Your name is love upon the cross. Hallelujah to the one, the Lamb of God, the risen Son. This is our everlasting song. Glory to your name, our God and our Savior. Worthy of praise, all the praise, all the praise. Forever you reign, almighty Redeemer. We are saved, we are saved, we are saved. Glory to your name, your name. Glory to your name, your name. All glory to the name above all names, Jesus, Jesus. All glory to the name above all names, Jesus, Jesus. Glory to your name, our God and our Savior. Worthy of praise, all the praise, all the praise. Forever you reign, almighty Redeemer. We are saved, we are saved, we are saved. Glory to your name, your name. Glory to your name, your name. Glory to your name, your name. Glory to your name, your name.
Amen. You may be seated. So if you're new to Berean, what we do here when we worship, we have a blended style worship. And what that means is we sing the best of the old and the best of the new. And we always sing a new song of the month. We learn a song throughout the month. And before we get into that song, I'd just like to talk a little bit, just a little couple minutes, on why I appreciate and believe in blended style, and to calm any concerns. This is not a rant from me saying, why, you're wrong if you don't like singing contemporary, if you don't like singing hymns. It's not about that. I'm just talking about why I love and believe in singing both. And so I'll start with talking about why I like singing new songs. First of all, because God commands us to. Psalm 33:3 says, sing to the Lord a new song. Play skillfully, shout for joy. When we're singing a new song, we're learning a new song, and it's got a freshness to it, if you let your spirit get into that. And you're also inspecting words. When you inspect them, you learn them, you understand them. And God keeps giving people the ability to write music, and for what greater cause than worshiping himself? And so he gifts these songwriters that are able to teach through song the truths that are in the scriptures. And, you know, every song that we sing that's been a part of our faith, even A Mighty Fortress Is Our God is now 500 years old, but in 1530 it was a new song. So every song that we sing was a new song at some point, and they become songs of our faith, such as that one is How Great Thou Art, It Is Well With My Soul, Because He Lives. All these great songs of our faith that were new songs at one time, that were learned and sung by congregations, and still, because of their timelessness, can teach us. They have a freshness to them. It'll be interesting to see what songs, that the new songs we sing now, how many of them will, you know, stand the test of time, and look back in 30 years, which ones will still be singing. I don't know. I'm pretty much bank on, you know, In Christ Alone, that'll be there. But others than that, who knows? We'll find out. But all we can do is sing them now and see what happens. So that's why I appreciate singing new songs. And on the other side, why I love singing the older songs, why we love singing the hymns. When you're saved, you are brought into this church that is much older and much bigger than your existence. You're part of something now that is beyond just your own generation and goes back now for 2,000 years. And so when we sing these songs that are old, we're uniting ourselves with our brothers and sisters who came before us in other generations. You see, we as a church universal, we are united beyond borders. But because of the eternity, the hope and eternity we have, we're united beyond time. That's unnatural, and it's very supernatural. And so that's why I like to sing these old songs that unite us. And I like to go even a little farther back than what our hymnals have, too. You see, our tradition, our church tradition, goes millennia. And so you can put up the title of the song of the month. This month is called "The King Shall Come When Morning Dawns." The message in the song, the doctrine in the song, they were sung in ancient Greek. This goes back to ancient Christianity, and it's been changed. Translated to different languages in different parts of the world throughout time. And it was translated into English about 100 years ago, and it was written in different melodies for different congregations to whatever the culture was of that congregation, where they were at. And so we're going to learn this song. And when we do it, you know, it's obviously not ancient Greek anymore because we translate to our own language, and the melody is not ancient Greek. You wouldn't like it if it were, trust me. But as we sing it, you have to remember that you're singing these texts that were sung by Christians for generations, for thousands of years. And at that moment, it's a very profound feeling of being united with them, knowing that we're going to meet them someday in heaven and we'll spend eternity with them. And so now we're singing ancient messages sung by generations before us with our own, you know, Berean melody, whatever it takes that we can learn the doctrines that are in here. And so when we sing a new song, naturally, you're not going to be able to grab on right away, and that's okay. It's rather just listen to the words, try to learn the messages in it. That's fine. But if you feel comfortable with trying to sing along, hey, I'm not going to stop somebody from singing in church. The King shall come when morning dawns and light triumphant breaks, when beauty gilds the eastern hills and life to joy awakes. Not as of old a little child to bear and fight but crowned with glory like the sun that lights the morning sky. The King shall come when morning dawns and light and beauty brings. Hail Christ the Lord, thy people pray, come quickly, King of Kings. Oh, brighter than the rising morn, when he victorious rose and left the lonesome place of death despite the rage of foes. Oh, brighter than that glorious morn shall this fair morning be, when Christ our King in beauty comes and we his face shall see. King shall come when morning dawns and light and beauty brings. Hail Christ the Lord, thy people pray, come quickly, King of Kings. The King shall come when morning dawns and earth's dark night is past. Oh, raise the rising of that morn, the day that I shall last. And let the endless bliss begin by weary saints foretold, when right shall triumph over wrong and truth shall be extolled. King shall come when morning dawns and light and beauty brings. Hail Christ the Lord, thy people pray, come quickly, King of Kings. The King shall come when morning dawns and light and beauty brings. Hail Christ the Lord, thy people pray, come quickly, King of Kings.
Father, we thank you so much that we've been, though our lives are in vapor, we've been added to something eternal. We do wait for that day. How you came already and died for our sins, but you are coming back again. We look for your kingdom. May your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Continue to guide us, to shape us, and we can be lights in this world. Amen.
Morning. Well, it's good to be back. Let's see. Just a little bit of announcements. Next Sunday evening, our Cornerstone group that went to Mexico will be giving a report. I just want to thank you guys for your prayers, your financial support that you provided for us. We so much needed your prayer. God saw fit to remove some of the crutches that I would have liked to have used during this mission trip and said, no, you don't need them. I'm sufficient. And he was. Sometimes I don't always get that, but he was that definitely sufficient. So I encourage you, if you're available next Sunday night, to come out to hear what God did in us. Boy, I needed a lot of construction. And what he did through us while we were there. Anyway, our scripture reading is found in John chapter 10, verses 9 through 18, and then skipping down to 27 through 30. If you would stand with me out of respect of reading God's word this morning. Again, John chapter 10, starting in verse 9 through 18. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy.
I came that they might have life and might have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is the hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them. He flees because he is a hireling and not concerned about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I receive from my Father. Verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them. And they shall never perish, and no one shall snatch them out of my hands. My Father has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. You may be seated. What a great truth there is. We cannot lose it. We always have it. I'll ask the ushers to come forward to receive the morning offering. And just want to bring our missionaries in focus in to attention. We have the Josh and Becky Brackville serving over at Camp Sankinac as they're in the girls' camp this week. We also have Fred and Iva DeVildis in North Carolina, and Luke and Jessica in Bolivia. And then we have our youth group, who's junior high, leaving on mission trip this coming week, that you guys would just be in prayer for them, and just a great opportunity that our youth leaders have to kind of get along with the kids, spend some one-on-one time with them, and then also just whet their appetite for short-term mission trips. So I'll give you a couple moments to pray for whatever the Lord has laid on your heart this morning, and then I will lead us in a time of audible prayer this morning. Let's go to the Lord. Father, as we come before you this morning, we only come because of what our great shepherd accomplished. That through his willingness to lay down his life, as we read, that we were restored once again to you. But not only was he willing to lay down his life that no one took it, but he also had authority to take it up once again and reigns victoriously right now, seated at your right hand, interceding for us, praying for us even when we don't know what to pray, knocking down the accusations of the adversary. What a great shepherd we have. Father, so often we try to run after the things that you already know that we need. And yet, as the 23rd Psalm reminds us, that you're the one who leads us to those green pastures. You're the one who leads us to those still waters. You're the one who protects us, even as we go through the shadow of the valley of death. Father, how we need to be close to our shepherd. For when we wander, that's when we get into trouble. Father, we know that the adversary desires to snatch and to scatter. And that's when he is powerful. But Father, when we are near to our great shepherd, that's where we are safest. Father, I thank you for your great provision. And I thank you first and foremost for your provision that you've given to us in the realm of the spiritual. Father, that we can now be called your children. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That he made the way. And there was nothing in us that would cause him to need to do that, to want to do that, but simply because of your great love for us. We thank you for that. And Father, because you are our great shepherd, you know our afflictions and the hurts and the sorrows that are in this congregation, Father, and there are many. And Father, so many of the things that we face are so much bigger than we are. Father, they are not bigger than you. We ask that you would work in these situations. Father, so detailed and so complex that the human mind can't even wrap their minds around some of these things. But yet, Father, they're nothing for you. Father, I just pray that as we work through these difficult situations as a church family, that you would be the one that would be honored and glorified, that your name would be lifted on high. Father, I pray for those that are laid aside because of physical illness and are unable to be here. Father, I pray that you would just draw near to them. Father, that if it be your will, that you would heal them and that you would raise them up again, that they would be able to join us. Father, for those that aren't here because they're away on vacation, that you would just give them just a great time of rest. And then, Father, those that simply choose not to be here, those that have wandered far from their shepherd, Father, I pray that you would bring whatever circumstances you need into their lives to bring them back to you. That's where they will find their true contentment and their true joy. Father, I pray that as your word goes forth this morning, that you would just anoint Jace, that we would hear from you as he brings your word. Father, we know that it will not return void, but that will accomplish your plans and purposes. Father, we know that your word is powerful, that your word is sufficient, and that your word is always relevant. Father, may we have the courage to apply the things that we learn today. I also pray for our general fund, Father, as the money comes in, that Father, that you would give us wisdom. We thank you for how you have blessed us here at Berean financially, and that, Father, that we would be good stewards of the resources that you have given to us, Father, that we would use it to see your kingdom further, that we would see lost souls won, and, Father, those souls that are already yours, that they would be strengthened in their relationship with you. Father, again, we thank you for this time. We commit it to you. We offer it in your Son's name. Amen.
So faithful, so constant, so loving and so true, so powerful. In all you do, you fill me, you see me, you know my every move, you love me to sing to you. I know that you are for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Steph. Everybody that played for her. A little light up here. Well, it is gardening season, isn't it? How many of you have gardens? Oh, goodness. How many of you wish you did? Okay, there's some. There you go. So everybody knows about gardening, and it's that time of year we're starting to get some of those wonderful, man, I got good tomatoes this year. I can't believe how good they are. And it's been a great year, but, you know, gardening is a lot like what we're talking about in 2 Peter chapter 1. Because, you know, when you garden, you know, we like to show off the things that we grow and things like that, but there's really not that much we put into it. And especially if you're farming on a large scale, you know, God has to provide the ground, and God provide. Without God, there's no seed. Without God, there's no water. I seen a study that was done. It said no matter what a farmer does, he's really only responsible for about 10% of what takes place. He needs a certain kind of ground, and of course, none of us has ever made a patch of dirt. And he needs the water. Unless you run big irrigation systems, and really, even that kind of thing isn't nearly as productive as natural rainfall. And so, but, you know, I look out my door, and I have a field in the back, and there's ground there, and waterfalls upon it. And, of course, nothing grows without sunshine. All that takes place. But I've looked out there and looked out there and looked out there. I don't have one stalk of corn in that field. I don't have one tomato. I don't have any peppers coming up, squash, peas, anything like that. Why? Because I didn't tend it. You know, I have a little pot right in front of my house. I have to put it right there in my garden bed because if I don't, the coons and the rabbits and the deer, I'm just feeding them all the time. But the rest of my field, it's grown up in what? Briars and brambles. It could be the best ground in the world, have all the water that's necessary, and nothing takes place. Nothing happens because I haven't done anything to it. I haven't worked that ground. Spiritually, we're talking about that in the same way this morning. Look at what we've done. Verses 1 to 4, it says, Simon Peter, a bondservant, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by those who, to those who have received a faith of the same kind as ours, by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything that pertains to life and godliness through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, in order that by them you might become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Remember, we went over that. And the context here is that he's writing believers, those who are like faith, those who sing the same faith as the apostles. Our faith is the same as the apostles. We're singing the same songs, that the song of the month, as the early Christians, the ancient Christians did. And we're made of the same faith as the apostles. The same faith that saved them saves us. And in verses 1 to 4, we said all these things that we have. That we have these promises, we have the same faith, we have this life that's been given unto us. We're partakers of the divine nature. Verses 1 through 4, all in one sentence there in the Greek, talk about what we have. But now as we move into verse 5, it's going to tell us, what are we going to do with that? What are we going to do with this spiritual garden that's been given to us? We've been prepared. There's been a preparation. There's sun there for us. There's soil there for us. There's ground for us to live in. It's called our salvation that's been provided for us. And so we move into this section of verse 5 where it says, now for this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, and your moral excellence knowledge. We're just going to look at that first phrase, look at preparation. The preparation that we have to set our to, it says, for these things, or now for this very reason, excuse me, apply all diligence. Now, Peter's urging his readers to grow to spiritual maturity. That's what it's about. It's about sanctification. It's about living in this new life, in this new nature that has been given to us. And this sanctification process in us, this practical sanctification, is a lifelong process for every genuine partaker of the divine nature. Paul calls it our sanctification, a progressive setting apart of believers from the corruption of the world and set apart unto God to make us useful and fruitful for his holy purposes. Paul talked about it, now Peter is. It starts out with now for this very reason. Now that you've heard these great truths, now that you have everything necessary for life and godliness, now that you have precious and magnificent promises, now that you have been made partakers of his divine nature, now in view of these incredible resources, work out your salvation. It's going to take effort, but not self-effort. It will take a faith effort. And Peter says, let's get on with it. Let's walk forward. You know, when you got saved, you took a step. People talked about taking a step of faith. Well, it doesn't end there. We're supposed to walk in that faith, laying hold of the promises that are ours in Christ. Because in Colossians 2, verse 10, it says, in him, in Christ, we have been made complete. We have all that we need. Since God is powerfully at work in you, we have to make every effort to work out our salvation. That's what Philippians 2, verses 12 to 13 is about. So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, Paul says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. You notice the word work three times there. Paul tells us, work, work, work. Peter tells us, walk, work. You've been given all the resources, and now you're responsible to use them. That's the reason. And you're to apply all diligence. All diligence. Do it with all diligence. We're supposed to supply the sweat. If I go out into my field and take that field and call it and plow it and cultivate it and, you know, sow it and weed it and tend it and shoot all the critters that come in it and spray it for all the things that are too little to shoot, what's going to happen? I'm going to get some. I'm going to supply the sweat. But here Paul says, Peter says, that we're to bring the maximum effort. That we're to apply all diligence. Applying, we're supposed to come alongside. Parisifero is the Greek word, to bring in alongside of. We're supposed to come alongside of the things that God has. We're not here working to get our salvation. And I'm going to tell you that some take verses 5 to 11. We're going to look at them in the next 2 weeks. And good men of God take this and they confuse it. And they start talking about our salvation and about our election and about predetermination, all that kind of stuff. They miss the boat on this. The context here is that we are saved. He's writing to save people. And he says, you have all these things now. How are you going to use them? He says you're to use them diligently. You're supposed to come alongside of God, come alongside of your salvation, and work it out. Cultivate it. You don't work to get saved, but you work because you are saved. We've been given all these great things. And he says, don't just do it with diligence. Peter says, do it with all diligence. Bring all of your energy to the task. Some of you probably have a neighbor like I have. I have a neighbor out there, and he has a pretty big backyard, and he has half of it in garden. And I'm going to tell you, this guy works in his garden like you want to. I bet there isn't a weed in that garden, and everything, he fenced it in. The thing looks beautiful. You should take a picture of it and put it in the magazine. He has got the nicest garden in the world. But I'm going to tell you, he puts maximum effort into it. He's working in that garden every single day. And in the middle of the garden, he has fruit trees. I'm going to go over there about midnight one night, and I'm getting myself a nice harvest is what's going to happen. Now, I'm just kidding. I wouldn't steal fruit, would I? I'm not that kind of guy, am I? But see, he's bringing all effort. He does maximum effort for his garden. Me, I put out a couple pepper plants, a couple tomato plants. I put them against the house. I have to put stuff around because the dog lays under them for shade and digs up the roots and kills them. He's the worst problem that I have with my garden in my front yard. But it's pretty much on its own. I don't make a lot of effort in it. That's not what Peter's talking about here. He's talking about getting saved and then not being like a log of wood or being like a stone wall. He's talking about being saved and having a faith that's active every day. See, when God saved us and he sent his grace, grace is something that ought to bring a reaction from us. It ought to make us active all the time. J. Vernon McGee, in his, if you've ever read his stuff, he has this really unique style, but he says, he describes all diligence, reminding us that the Christian life is a very serious business. However, we've made it sort of an extracurricular activity. The present-day thinking is that it's not something to be taking into the business world or into the schoolroom or even into our social lives. Rather, it's something sort of like your Sunday go-to-meeting clothes, which you wear only at certain times. However, Peter said that it's something to which we should give all diligence. See, a lot of people get saved and say, that's all I need. That's all I need. Jesus did it all. Let go and let God. Now listen, in your salvation, to bring you to salvation, Christ did it all. He died on the cross. You're going to remember that in a little bit. He did it all for your salvation. But he didn't endorse you could sit around and do nothing after your salvation. That's it. Hanging out, waiting for heaven. Just a log floating down the stream. He says, you need to do it with all diligence. You need to work out your salvation with all diligence. Do it in your faith. Do it in your faith. He doesn't talk here about us supplying faith. He talks about us applying our faith. Bringing it together. See, when you got saved, that wasn't the end of the matter. Faith isn't the end of the matter. It's not over. It's the beginning of the matter. When you come to know Christ and you're saved, then you work because of that salvation. See, faith, true faith, never stands around with its hands in its pockets. True faith doesn't sit back and rest and do nothing. Instead, it gets active. It comes with a plan. See, if I'm going to put my field into use sometime, and I want to, see, I need the tools that are necessary. The land is there, the water's there, the sun is there. I need a tractor. Because it's too much. And I need some ambition. That's the biggest thing I need. Well, look at that. Some perseverance, I guess. I need to lay out a plan. I need to lay out the crop. You know, you don't plant a garden without planning how it does. A farmer doesn't look at his fields and say, well, I'm just going to go out there and drive around. I'm going to buy some seed. I don't know what it is. Throw it out there and see what comes up. That's not good when you work that way. That's not how you cultivate a garden. That's not how you do something spiritually either. I know, you know, I go down and buy the plants. You ever buy the plants, like the pepper plants and stuff like that, the tomato plants, stuff like that, and then you get home and they have it all worked out. This is what you have, and then you plant it, and it's not what they say it is. You get those? It's a different kind of pepper when they come up. It's a, you know, you want them tomatoes. I hate cherry tomatoes, them little things. That's not a tomato. That's, I don't know what that is. I want big things like that. And it says, here's a tomato. You got an early girl. You got a big boy, a better boy, a not-so-great boy. You're all them boy tomatoes. And then they got girl tomatoes, early girl and late girl and middle girl and heavy girl and thin girl. Something like that. And I buy them by the label and I put them in, and what comes up? Cherry tomatoes. I yank them out and start over again. You got to have a plan. You got to bring it about. It's a big production. You want to switch the thing from garden a little bit, because Peter uses a word here in verse 5. He says, in your faith, supply. In your faith, he says, I want you to epikoregio. The word comes from the word for chorus. Or choreography. It's a word that when people read it in Peter's day, they said, I know what that is. I know what a choreago is. Choreago is someone who is a patron of the arts. You know, the Greeks were great for their tragedies and their dramas when every town would have them. And when you had a town, you would have these big choruses that would stand behind all the production. And there would be a patron in that city, a wealthy man, who would have this very abundant supply, and he would pay for the chorus. And he would pay for the production of the play. The play was put out there. Euripides and all of those Greek guys that we still have to read in school sometimes, or that you're supposed to read and don't. But these patrons would abundantly supply. Many times it would cost them 3,000-4,000 drachma to put this play on. A drachma is worth, one drachma is worth a day's labor to a common person. So only wealthy people would say it. And here Peter says, uses this word, and he says, bring your abundant supply to this. Well, God's given us the resources. He said, use them. Produce with them. You know, in Hollywood today, this person who was the choreago would be the producer who brings everything together. We're supposed to lavishly work together with God. He says, hey, you supply. And only wealthy people supply. Well, you say, I'm not so wealthy. Yes, you are wealthy. Look at verses 1 to 4. Look at what you have. Look at the resources that are at your disposal. is if you take these resources and you begin to work with them, you're going to start to produce things. You're going to start to change who you are, and when you change who you are, you can change the world around you. And you'll be ready to face the world around you. So first you prepare, and everyone's going to say, we are all wealthy. If you know Christ as your Savior, you have all the resources necessary to live a godly and successful life. And in verse 5b, he starts to tell us about this cultivation. First we have preparation, now we have cultivation. He says, in your faith supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence knowledge, and in your knowledge self-control, and in your self-control perseverance, and in your perseverance godliness, and in your godliness brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness Christian love. Out of your faith, in the sphere of your faith, should come all of these things. Should come out of us. First, we have to produce them in us because of the resources that God has provided, because of the work of the Holy Spirit, but they don't just happen. We have to work at it. We have to cultivate these things. And the first one is, he says, uses there, is supply or choreograph your moral excellence. Some translate it virtue. Courage and excellence of life. He says that's what you ought to be cultivating. You ought to have the courage to excel at life. You ought to be able to stand on your own two feet in Jesus Christ. That's what it's saying. That's what it is. You know, our translation, some miss the idea of having courage, having the ability to stand, having the ability to stand for Christ and be counted for Him. That's what that word means. Moral excellence. To be of a courageous spirit. To be excellent in your lifestyle. And also flowing out of that faith and that moral excellence is knowledge. Our word gnosis again. Not the epigenosis, but the gnosis, which is more the practical knowledge, discernment, the ability to handle life. See, because we have all the resources that Christ has given us, we should be able to handle life, folks. Life shouldn't kick us around. We should kick life around. We have the resources to stand. And knowledge, of course, again, comes from the Word of God. We've been talking about that over and over again. That doctrine's fallen into disuse in the churches, and because of that, nobody knows anything about the Word of God. You have to know the Word of God to grow. You're going to have a stunted garden if you don't feed it. If you don't weed it. Yet I've seen recently in a survey of those who said that they were born again, those who said they knew Christ as their Savior. There was a survey done, and 25% who said they believe in Christ as their Savior also believe in communication with the dead, also believe in astrology, also believe in reincarnation. I didn't get those things from the Word of God. As a matter of fact, God forbids astrology. He forbids communication with the dead. And reincarnation is just a teaching of Eastern thought and Eastern mysticism. How does that come into a church? Because people are not growing in their knowledge. You got to know to grow. And out of knowledge, it says, from self-control. Put in the modern vernacular, he says you need to get a grip. If you cultivate the resources of God, you can get a grip. You can have power over your passions. You can be master over your old nature. The word here in the Greek is a word that we use of athletes in training. You know, anybody who is an elite athlete is very self-disciplined. They don't sit in front of a TV and eat a bag of chips like I do. There was a time that I was athletically fit, believe it or not. There was a time I could have came and run against you guys. There was a time I could have came and wrestled with you guys. There was a time I could have came and played basketball and football with you guys. If I'm ever going to do anything like that again, and I'm at the age where even if I do, I can't keep up with you, I have to incorporate some self-discipline. We need to submit to the fruit of the Spirit. And then we can have self-control. Galatians 5, 22 and 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. A list very similar to that. Right here, 7 of them. This is a number of perfection. Someone has said the beginning of self-mastery is to be mastered by Christ. It's to yield to His lordship in our life. And then we'll have power over the passions. We rely upon the resources to have victory over our old nature. And then he goes from moral excellence to knowledge, and knowledge to self-control, and then your self-control, perseverance. This word means to remain under, to see it through, to do what is right and not give up, to never quit. Christians should never be quitters. Christians should never throw up their hands and say, I can't do it. We have the resources to persevere. We have the resources to remain under. And this word doesn't mean, oh, you know, I have this grim and passive endurance. I just have to hang in there. I just have to make it through. Why won't the Lord come back and get me? Why won't the Lord relieve me of this? No, this is about actively overcoming. Not simply suffering things, but vanquishing them. Not simply enduring, but being victorious. Not languishing in our trouble, but triumphing over it. It's using the blows of life. That doesn't mean they're not going to come, but using those blows as stepping stones to new achievement. This word in the Greek carries with it a vibrant hope. When we're told to persevere, you need to keep that in there. Well, I just get... No, you don't just have to make it through. I will succeed because I have all the resources, because I am in Christ. We will persevere. So we have hope. Right? So you're like, oh, I don't know about that. You don't know what I'm going through, Pastor. We persevere. We go through. When Beethoven was threatened with deafness, you know, Beethoven went deaf. A musician, the great musician, Beethoven went deaf, which is the most terrible of troubles for a musician. You know what he said when they told him you're going deaf? He said, then I'll take life by the throat. Someone once said to a gallant soul who was undergoing a great sorrow, they said, sorrow fairly colors your life, doesn't it? And back came the reply, yes, and I propose to choose the color. See, you choose the colors of life. It wasn't that long ago. We had June Carroll, a tape of her, and we said, here's a woman who perseveres. She's not just enduring all the physical ailments that she's been through. She's triumphing in that. Because she's tapping into the resource of Christ. She's not doing that of her own ability, of her own strength. She's choreographing that with God. And with perseverance comes what next? Godliness. And godliness is just a practical awareness of God in every area of life. We should have a life of reverence both for God and for other people. Godliness is serving the greater good in everything that we do. Godliness is a lifestyle. A lifestyle showing reverence for God as we live before others. We may say we worship God on Sunday, but what was Monday like? Do you give in to the pagan darkness around you? Or do you express the fact that you're serving a higher king than the one who's over this world of darkness? Are you willing to take the heat because you're worshiping God through your life? God, this is worshiping God through your life. Godliness is living one's life in the conscious presence of the holiness of God. And that consciousness comes from devotion to the Word of God, to prayer, to self-denial, to discipline, to accountability, to worship, to communion. And every means that God brings to bring ourselves into captivity to Himself. Godliness is love for God, and it's walking in the ways of God. And from godliness, he talks about brotherly kindness. And of course, he uses the word phileo here. Actually, the word in the Greek, exactly in the text here, is a Philadelphian. Now, I've been to Philadelphia. So my image of a Philadelphian is not the best, because usually when I go down there, I don't go to the greatest parts of town. But I could go down there and say to those people, listen, Christ will give you the resources to be a true Philadelphian. And phileo was used of the love of members of a family. That as Christians, you recognize your family. Then use Philadelphia, you're talking about loving someone outside the family. This is familiar love. This is the love of a mother and a father and children and brothers and sisters. It's the love of belonging. Oh, how many Christians, how many people in the world today don't know that they belong anywhere. They don't know where they belong. They feel isolated. They feel alone. They sit in a church and they feel alone. They feel like nobody cares about them. No one loves them. Well, listen, folks, we've got to reach out to others, but if you're sitting there feeling alone, maybe you need to reach out to us, too. And recognize that you are loved. You are loved by God, first of all. And if God loves you, how could we not love you? If God put us together as a family, we need to conduct ourselves as a family. And for brotherly kindness, then to the other kind of love, the agape love. The love of the will. The love that drove Christ to go to the cross for us. The kind of love that says, I don't care how you look. I don't care what you've done. I'm going to love you. Christ said, I love you in all of your sin. When you were yet enemies, Christ died for us. Christ went to the cross. And he says, that's the love we should exhibit to others. And of course, that love is kind of the crowning characteristic. The crowning character trait it ought to be of every believer in Christ. Showing forth the love of Christ. John MacArthur explains it this way. He says, agape love is the greatest virtue of the Christian life. Yet that type of love was rare in pagan Greek literature. That's because the traits of agape, which portray unselfishness, self-giving, willful devotion, concern for the welfare of others, these things were mostly disdained in the ancient Greek culture as signs of weakness. But in the Scriptures, in the Word of God, in the New Testament, the Apostle John writes, God is love, and the one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. 1 John 4:16. That's what we ought to be exhibiting. Lifestyle, a cultivation of our characters, of our character and things. And then in verse 8, I quickly have to do this. We should have expectation. You know, we should add these things to our faith. What is necessary in our faith? What can we supplement with these seven elements? We can even put flesh on them. Add to your faith courage. Some man wrote these for his children. He said, add to your faith the virtue or courage of David, and to the courage of David, the knowledge of Solomon, and to the knowledge of Solomon, the patience of Job, and to the patience of Job, the godliness of Daniel, and to the godliness of Daniel, the brotherly kindness of Jonathan, and to the brotherly kindness of Jonathan, the love of John. And if you do that, there's an expectation. We plant a garden, we expect to harvest. In verse 8 it says, "For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." He said, bring these things together increasingly. Build them up. Present tense. It's continually growing. We have to ask ourselves this morning, am I growing or am I in a rut? Am I growing and producing or am I a stunted garden? Have you seen a garden that hasn't been cultivated? Have you seen a garden that hasn't been weeded or protected? The guy says, there's my pepper plants. I'm like, what is that? It's all shriveled up. It's got no fruit on it. I said, well, you might as well pull that out. Nobody took care of it. Nobody cultivated it. And so the expectation is gone. But that's not the way our life should be. That's the way our garden should be. A spirit-filled life that is increasing is an overflowing light. See, if you come to my house right now, I'll say, hey, you need some tomatoes? You need some peppers? I can't eat them all. I'm giving them away. They're beautiful. You can get them for nothing at my place. I grew some kind of peppers. I don't even know what you use them for. I got some Tabasco peppers. I think the only thing you can make with them is sauce. I don't use Tabasco sauce. The thing's growing into a tree out there. I pulled one off and ate it yesterday. It almost took me to my knees. But listen, I've got an increase. I've got an overflowing. And that's what we should have in our spiritual life as well. Because if we don't, we can be useless. See, people want to talk about salvation here. No, this is about saved people being useless. All of us know people that come around and they come to know Christ and then they kind of drift away and if you see them, say, oh, I know the Lord is my Savior. But there's nothing happening in their life. And eventually that ends in tragedy for them. They become useless. Useless to the Lord. You know, you can be saved and be useless to the Lord. This word for useless is argos. And it talks about someone, not someone who is unavoidably unemployed, but someone who's failing to do his job. You probably work with some people like that. You think, that guy's useless. That guy's drawing a paycheck. That guy's costing the company money. Think that doesn't happen spiritually? And then he says some are unfruitful. They're saved, but they're not bearing any fruit. They remain infants. They fail to produce faith. Now, think about your life. Think about this, young people. I don't think anybody in their right mind would set out at age 16, 18, 20, whatever you are, and say, you know what? I'd like to waste my life. And nobody writes out a plan for a wasted life. No one says, so you know what I think I'm going to do? I think I'm going to watch TV like 7 or 8 hours a day. And I'm going to plan to become an addict. I'm going to become addicted to alcohol and drugs. I got a plan to live so selfishly and with such disregard for others that I'm going to shred all of my relationships with people. And you know what else I'm going to do? I'm going to spend money until I'm into debt up to my eyeballs. Nobody plans to be useless and unfruitful in this life. But yet there are people in the body of Christ who are doing that. It just happens. I'm saved, Pastor. What about what you're doing with your salvation? We don't have to do anything. Paul, Peter say, walk, work, move forward, cultivate. Because if not, you're going to have Christians who are idle and barren. Saved, and that's all. Just think of that. If you take in that lifestyle, 2 Corinthians 5:10, it says you're going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether it's good or bad. Talking about believers there, folks. And in 1 Corinthians 3:13, 14, and 15, it says, and each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it because it is to be revealed with fire, and the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. Not talking about losing your salvation. He's talking about the testing of your work, what you did with the resources, these abundant, magnificent promises that were given to you. And if any man's work which he has built on it remains, he will receive a reward. And if any man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. I don't know what that exactly entails to say he will suffer loss in heaven. I don't know, but I don't want to be. Do you want to find out what that is? Is that your plan? Are you growing or are you in a rut? We should all be growing, healthy, fruit-bearing individuals and a growing, healthy, fruit-bearing church. I'm going to end with this and what we ought to plant in this church. In a growing, healthy, fruit-bearing church, we ought to try this plan. And it's not mine, but I like it. It says, plant 3 rows of squash. Squash gossip, squash criticism, and squash indifference. And it says, plant 7 rows of peas. Prayer, promptness, perseverance, politeness, preparedness, purity, and patience. And then it says you ought to plant 7 heads of lettuce in your church. Let us be unselfish and loyal. Let us be faithful to duty. Let us search the scriptures. Let us not be weary in well-doing. Let us be obedient in all things. Let us be truthful. Let us love one another. That's 7 rows of peas if you go back. And no garden is complete without turnips. But I don't know what you do with turnips. When I was a kid, they used to make turnip sandwiches, but I don't recommend them to you. Right, Jeff? You've never had a turnip sandwich, but I know you won't like them. That'll be worse than Jell-O, I guarantee you. But in a church, you want turnips. You want to turn up for church. You want to turn up for meetings and prayer times and Bible studies. You want to turn up with a smile, even when things are difficult. And you want to turn up with determination to do your best in God's service. And if you do that, you will grow. If you do that, you'll be successful. If you do that, we're working out our salvation. Amen? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word this morning. And Father, we know we weren't saved just to sit on the sidelines and wait for heaven. We were saved to grow. We were saved to put our salvation to work. We had no part in receiving life. You did that for us. But now that you've given us that life, you expect us to cultivate it, to grow in, and to bring forth a harvest. Pray that we might remember that in a day when it's very easy for Christians to sit back and to do nothing, to be very much enamored with the things of the world, to play in the weeds, to enjoy the weeds even, and never realize that there's never going to be fruit in that avenue. We'll never get anything but brambles and briars and cuts and scrapes and defeat. Father, help us to triumph in the world in which we live. And help us, Father, to work out our salvation in a way that we draw others into yourself. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand as we sing, I Need Thee Every Hour.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine
can be support. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and divine, for life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Amen. You may be seated.
Come to the table of the Lord this morning to remember that without Him, and He talked about it. He compared what He did to a kernel of grain, to wheat. He says, unless that kernel dies, it can't bring forth fruit. We couldn't bring forth anything. We couldn't work out any salvation unless Christ had gone to the cross of Calvary for us. We could dig in the dirt. We could do whatever. We could try to work out things, and guess what would happen? Nothing. There would be no fruit. There would be no fruit at all. But because of what Christ did for us at Calvary, we have all things. Everything that's necessary was provided to us in Christ. He died for us. Down to the grave, and 3 days later He rose again. And now He's with the Father, and He lives for us, and He intercedes for us, and He's coming again for us. And He says, remember me. Remember me. How can we forget? This is time to remember in a special way, and to do it even as a family of believers. I'm going to give you a moment to prepare yourselves, and then we will proceed. Scriptures tell us in the night in which the Lord Jesus was betrayed that He took the bread, He blessed it and broke it, and He passed it out to His disciples, and He said, take it. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Mr. Chairman of Board, Earl Lynch, to return thanks for the body of the Lord.
Lord, how marvelous and wonderful it is that You have wrought such a great salvation. Lord, we thank You. Jesus, the Lord.
Mm-hmm. long as you far away, stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and sin. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old cross, and he saves you someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, look wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, his shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
And now, just before we partake of the bread, which is the symbol of the body of the Lord Jesus given up for us that day on the cross of Calvary, let's thank him together by saying, I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your body, which was given for me. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your body, which was given for me. As you partake, remember the same.
Just this morning in our Sunday school time with the guys, we've been taking a look at Psalm 51, which is the story of David's confession of his sin after his adultery with Bathsheba and the murder of her husband. And one of the most fascinating lines in that entire psalm, and probably you guys will know this one, is where he says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God." And that is a fantastic statement, because he uses the word create there, which is the same word that appears in Genesis 1:1 for when God created out of nothing all that there is. In the beginning, God created from nothing the heavens and the earth. See, what David understood is without, I mean, God doing that work, you know, without God taking the initiative and creating in him a clean heart, he could never be right with God. And I wonder, you know, as David, you know, I mean, looked down through the centuries, I mean, did he understand that there would be a Savior coming who would go to a cross to make that possible? That by the shed blood of Jesus Christ, we could have a new heart. We could be declared a new creation, no longer slaves to sin, but we could be clean in the eyes of God. What a wonder we have to celebrate this morning. And on the old rugged cross, Jesus shed his precious blood to make possible what David stated so long ago, create in me a clean heart. There's nothing more valuable than that. Have a clean heart before God because of the work of Christ. I'd like to ask Deacon Ron Fronheiser to return thanks for the cup.
Father, thank you for loving us so much that you sent your Son to die for us and take our sins away from us that we so richly deserve. Thank you, Lord, for this in Jesus' name.
His hands up, bleeding side, I'm blameless life, I'm damned to die. For my sin he was crucified, I'll grieve the love of Jesus Christ. Through the scars of the righteous one, Satan fails, hell is undone. Death is conquered, the victory's won. How great the love of God the Son. There is no power, there is no grave that could ever separate me from his love and saving grace. How great the love that overcame. Upon the cross of Calvary, the blood was shed that pardons me. No longer bound, no more defeat. I'll take the love of Christ my King. There is no power, there is no grace that could ever separate me from his love and saving grace. How great the love that overcame. There is no power, there is no grace that could ever separate me from his love and saving grace. How great the love that overcame. There is no death, there is no height,
There is no valley nor ocean wide that comes between his heart and mine. How great the love of Jesus Christ. How great the love of Jesus Christ. How great the love of Jesus Christ.
Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Thank you for the wondrous love of Jesus Christ that binds us forever to you, Lord. By this symbol that we hold in our hands, the reality that represents the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the final payment for sin. Lord, thank you for your love. Thank him with this simple prayer. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood, which was shed for me. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood, which was shed for me. Now drink to the wonder of the love of God.
Today is that once a month time when we remember his body broken for us, his blood shed for us, and his victory over death. Because of that, we are saved. And so because of our salvation, we recognize the grace he has in our lives, and that's why we are called to work, to cultivate, to work out our salvation in fear and trembling. But we know we can't do it on our own. We need him to guide us the whole way through. So please stand as we sing, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Precious Lord, take my hand, beyond help me stand. I cried, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way goes dim, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Lest I fall, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears, and the nights are clear, and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, find my feet, hold my hand. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Father, we thank you that you give us all the tools. Everything is here. You saved us. You brought us out. You give us grace. We did nothing to earn our salvation. It was given to us as a free gift. And now you continue to guide us to live a holy life, a godly life that we can please you with. Teach us to please you. Let us rest on the truths in your word and be able to hold each other accountable to them as we build each other up. Thank you for our family that you've given us. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.